golden wings are declining because there is limited young forest on the East Coast in the Appalachians. They're pretty stable here in Minnesota yet so far, but we're just trying to get on top of that and prevent them from being put on the endangered species list. Mm-hmm. And habitat loss of breeding habitat is the main reason that they're on the decline. There's a couple other things. It's stopover habitat when they migrate. We're looking at trying to find some ways to manage that better. Their winter range is constantly being threatened by converting rainforests into coffee plantations, wide open coffee plantations, as opposed to a shade grown coffee plantation. Mm-hmm. That looks a lot like what we're looking at now. They are a priority because of the decline. Mm-hmm. I think it was about 2012, a bunch of local experts got together and put together this group called the Golden Wing Warbler Working Group, and they came up with a bunch of best management practices for each region. Great Lakes is one of them, and mm-hmm. I'm putting those BMPs to work on the ground here in Minnesota.
My name is Jerry Havel, and I'm the owner of the property, and we run Pine Ridge Grouse Camp out of here. We were approached by a friend from U.S. Fish and Wildlife, Tom Cooper, mm-hmm. who told me to get in contact with Kevin about creating some young forest habitat for warblers and woodcock, grouse, bear, deer, anything that uses and thrives on young forest management. Mm-hmm. So Tom gave me Kevin's number. Kevin and I talked, filled out the paperwork. It was pretty seamless.
The timber that was here was about 40-year-old aspen, so it was fairly healthy. Nice size for a mill, not too big. It wasn't rotten. There was no conks in it. It was a nice stand of wood. But Jerry kind of wanted to regenerate that and make some young forest habitat. So I didn't cut any of the oaks through those oak stands that we walked through before. That's great post-fledge habitat. So when these golden wings fledge, the mother takes half the brood, the father takes the other half, and they disperse into the mature timber to raise their brood. Mm-hmm. So they're born and bred in this young forest, and they move to the big stuff for the rest of the summer. This is a good example of post-fledge habitat. We just walked through that young aspen regen right back there. This is where they will bring their broods to raise during the rest of the summer. And what I look for in here that makes it a good quality site is the structure, the vertical structure. I have low shrubs, medium shrubs. I got suppressed and intermediate trees, and I have canopy trees. And a lot of diversity made up of bur oak. There's an elm. There's ash. I got some snags back there, some dead trees. It's just and some birch. It's a good site. Very, very good post-fledge habitat.
My name's Carl Peterson. I bought this property a year and a half ago, mm-hmm. after looking at it for about 6 months, just for recreation, for hunting. Mm-hmm. Didn't know anything about the golden wing warbler. Then I did a stewardship plan, mm-hmm. and got introduced to Kevin, and he started the golden wing warbler process. After learning about the golden wing, I want to have the aspen regenerate, golden wing warbler habitat, woodcock, grouse, deer, just all the wildlife species. Mm-hmm. It was so old that it wasn't beneficial to wildlife. It was just too old. Mm-hmm. So now it'll attract a lot more wildlife. We took out about 30 acres of reserve to leave for the habitat.
We call them legacy patches in the forestry world. Instead of having scattered leaf trees, you can have some of these legacy patches like that. Mm-hmm. And when the males are singing, they're flying from patch to patch. I've actually seen them do it in some areas where they really go from one patch to one patch to one patch and then back again. They're really active. We call this a clear cut with reserves. Basically that means we're removing pretty much all of the mature timber except for some some of these scattered reds and whites. And we also reserved some hardwoods. You can see these trees with the orange bands on them. We left about 12 per acre. It's with the BMPs for the Golden Wing requires. They need those for perches. The Golden Wing, when they attract their mate in the spring, they don't have a very loud call, so they need to get up high in a crown and broadcast their call. The research has found that they're a lot more successful if you leave trees out there for them to call from. It also results in maybe shading out the area slightly and not getting such dense regeneration, because Golden Wings like that patchiness of not just a continuous floor of aspen, you know, little openings here, just small micro openings. And those leaf trees tend to give that quality, or produce that quality really well. Next year, I'm imagining that we're going to have aspen head tall by this time of the year next year. So, and pretty dense. Sometimes when you cut in the summer like this, it can retard the regeneration a little bit. But that's not such a bad thing for golden wings and a lot of young forest creatures, because it kind of creates more of that patchiness too. When this timber is mature again, you'll never even, it'll still be fully stocked. You're still going to have, you know, 20, 30 cords per acre. It's just going to be good young forest habitat for a little bit longer. This was cut probably a month and a half ago, and this is aspen. It's coming up already. Aspen regen. Almost waist high already.
Wow.
In some of these sites. And this actually looks like a birch stump sprout on this birch stump already coming up, responding very fast. Here's an ash seedling coming up right there too. We didn't do any shelter wood cutting. It was nothing fancy. Just come in and regenerate this aspen and make a nice young forest. The equipment that we used to harvest this was a cut-to-length equipment. So all the wood was processed on the stump and forwarded out to a semi and hauled away. We reserved some oaks in here. Some of them have blown down since it happened, but it's such a small, narrow cut that the best management practices didn't require any leaf trees, because the golden wings can fly from one side to the other really easily. If it was larger, we always include leaf trees or legacy patches. As you can see here, we've had a lot more stuff actually regenerate. When just looking at the forest, you know, we got some sugar maple right here. This is black ash. There's a whole lot of black ash in here. We got a basswood coming up in here, and most of these, another basswood there. The rest of this other stuff is just trembling aspen that's coming up. Pretty dense. Probably well over 20,000 stems per acre. Understory of some hazel brush and other forbs and grasses. So it came back really nice, and it really responded very well to the timber sale.
Is this what a landowner can expect it to look like after a couple years?
Yes, this is exactly what I'm looking for, is this dense regen. I might have preferred it to be a little more patchy out here with some more grassy openings and, you know, smaller little micro sites, but when you harvest in the winter, you always get such good flush of regrowth that oftentimes you don't get that. If we walked through it, we'd find those areas, but there's so much sunlight attracted to these trails that they really grow, so we're kind of, what you're seeing is a big wall of wood, you know, but beyond that, it is pretty patchy out there. So, and that's where the golden wings like to nest, not right in the dense stuff, but in the patchiness. They love patchiness. A perfect example of the patchiness that I was talking about on this property and the Peterson property before, how a little bit of shade left in place will create these little micro sites. This is excellent golden wing nesting habitat right here. And just beyond it, dense regen again, and dense regen behind us again too. So patchiness, micro sites, a lot of diversity. This site has it all right here. We actually have a monitoring crew that comes through in the spring, mm-hmm. and they have been putting bird count surveys in all these cuts, mm-hmm. and they have seen golden wings right in here.
A couple right. pairs. Yep. Well, I mean a bunch of birds.
Yeah, so it's responding very well, and there's golden wings actually nesting on the property right now. Or not now, they fledged into the big stuff, but this mm-hmm. spring they definitely had pulled off some broods.
You know, obviously we've seen an increase in not just the warbler population, mm-hmm. but I think when they do the survey every year, there's something like 25 bird species in their testing or in their surveying that they highlight. And every year the numbers have gotten better, especially with obviously the warblers, mm-hmm. The woodcock, the grouse, some of the thrushes, and I mean some other birds. So we don't want to change anything because it's working, and why change it if it's working literally to plan mm-hmm. when we set forth a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. So it's been very, very successful.
My son and daughter love to deer hunt. The grandkids now, he'll turn 4 next week, so hopefully he'll be a hunter.
Yeah.
And my dad hunted his whole life, and my brothers and my whole family.
That sounds like a great way to share this with your family.
Yeah, they'll enjoy it for many years.
I do a lot of self-reading and have a lot of experts that tell me what to do. Mm-hmm. But, you know, some of the stuff probably, you know, we'd probably like to go in and know 15, 20 years and maybe do an acre or two cut, you know, do a little checkerboarding to get some more young regen going, mm-hmm. You know, keep it in mixed age classes, mm-hmm. you know, not just for the warblers, but for other, you know, other young forest species as well. Like I said, the grouse and woodcock and oven birds and those guys. So, you know, that's kind of what that, you know, we sat down with Kevin and kind of talked about that, you know, in 15 years, we're going to have to maybe reevaluate how this is doing and maybe do some smaller cuts, you know, again, keep that checkerboard and keep it managed, you know, instead of having it mature out like it was, you know, keep on top of it so it sustains for a lot longer.
Great. Yeah, before we started the logging process, I went and introduced myself, and not only because of the logging, but I just wanted to know who the neighbors were. So because this is such a big piece of property, there's about 8 property owners that neighbor the touch the property. So we did talk about the wildlife benefit of logging and harvesting the timber. So they were all very encouraging on the logging and knowing that it would better the habitat.
Do you have any advice for other landowners who might want to harvest for wildlife?
Yeah, do it. I mean, it's mm-hmm. it's fun. It's beyond educational. We're kind of a dog training facility. So we don't do any harvesting any of the birds here, but we use them for training. Mm-hmm. And so when you've got a bunch of broods of grouse and woodcock here, it's nice to see them on the roads in the fall and hear them drumming in the spring. And so, I mean, if you can get on the program and hook up with somebody that can give you some advice, take it, but get the right people, you know, talk to the, you know, you guys, the University of Minnesota Extension or ABC, mm-hmm. NRCS, because again, everybody thinks they know what they're doing on wildlife management and habitat regeneration, but they don't. Mm-hmm. So if you're interested, hook up with some good people. There is money available for programs out there. We participated in one that was part of the 15 Farm Bill, I think. So like I said, there's money there out there to assist you to do what we've done here on our 160 acres. So definitely strongly recommend it, but do it with people that know.
Choosing a good logger, mm-hmm. That means a lot. Mm-hmm. It and finding, you know, finding the guy that's going to do it the way you want it to have it done means a lot, and being comfortable with them too.
How did you know that you were picking a well-qualified logger?
Well, I'd interviewed him. I've talked to 3 or 4 of the big mills around that he sells wood to, and they recommended him. One of the mills that they sell their pine to, a sawmill, he brings a lot of pine in there. They recommended him. I talked to the Master Logger Association and got all of his kind of background, and they said he was a good logger.
Okay.
So, and then just talking to him, I could tell that he that he cared about the property more than just getting the wood off. He cared about taking care of the property as he was logging.
What's your favorite warbler of all the warblers?
Yeah.
Well, I gotta say it's the golden wing.